York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null, here to share as much insight as possible within the next 55 minutes of how to live a longer and healthier life. Getting updates on the environment, what we can do, what we should do. My guest in the second part of our program, and I'm devoting a half hour to him, because it's a continuation of our Conversations with Remarkable Minds series. A look back at the origins of America as an incoherent empire. Professor Michael Mann, a distinguished research professor of sociology, University of California, Los Angeles, specializing in fascism and how humans use and abuse power to perpetuate violence, including institutionalized ethnic cleansing. He is the author of the four-volume series, The Source of Social Power, which traces the history of power and its abuse in human societies from prehistoric times to the present. And in fact, it was a few years ago that he published a very important, insightful book called Incoherent Empire, which critiques the U.S. War on Terror as a clumsy experiment in neo-imperialism. He is also the co-author of the more recent Does Capitalism Have a Future?, published by Oxford University. And he holds a doctorate in sociology from Oxford and also has McGill University, University College Dublin, University of Aberdeen, and he's been a professor at Cambridge University, London School of Economics, Yale University, and elsewhere. So you're going to hear one of the brightest minds on the planet talking about how we are just one screwed-up nation. Democrats and Republicans equally responsible, from the Clintons and Obama and Bushes and, of course, Trump. A sad group, and sadder still that anyone believes in any of the projects that these people are involved in. Also today, from the World Mercury Project, from Professor James Wheeler, why are the same people who failed at science on Agent Orange now in charge of our vaccine safety and development disorders at the CDC? We're going to be looking at Dr. Frank DiStefano and Dr. Colleen Boyle and what they have done that you're not aware of that you should be. But we always begin with the latest on health and healing. The latest study comes from the University of Pittsburgh, and it talks about women with normal blood pressure during pregnancy who breastfeed their babies for at least 6 months following birth had better markers for cardiovascular health years later compared to women who never breastfed. And this was based upon research from the American College of Cardiology's annual scientific session. So that's important. So it means that if you're a woman and you have normal blood pressure, you're going to help your heart save your life if you breastfeed. And if you don't have normal blood pressure, it's easy to get it under control, but still breastfeed. Right now in season are these crispy apples. They're called crispy apples. They are delicious. They're juicy, and if it's cold, and it's just perfect on a hot day. And they only come once a year, and I suggest them. Guy apples, I also suggest. But I believe everyone should have at least an apple or two per day. I've done a lot of research on apples as to why they're one of nature's most perfect foods. But so, too, has the University of Iowa. And they're talking about, because apples are widely consumed, they're good, but why? What exactly makes them good? So I want to do a little tutorial now on this, because the apple is rich in phytochemicals. Phyto, meaning plant-based chemicals. And all of the epidemiological studies have linked the consumption of apples with reduced risk of some cancers, cardiovascular disease, meaning stroke and heart attacks, asthma, and diabetes. And also, it has the prowess to stimulate the immune system to make us optimally well more often than not. Now, scientists have found that fruit is more effective than other superfoods, including green tea and blueberries, as a source of antioxidants and chemicals that contain what are called flavonoids. But the apple is really a superstar, and it's underappreciated. Why? Because it can actually combat potentially life-threatening conditions. For example, the scientific literature supports that two apples a day have been found to be more effective at reducing heart disease than statin medications. And previous research has found that what is called ursolic acid, U-R-S-O-L-I-C, in apple skin, remember how I told you take the four apples and skin them, put the skins in a blender, because that way you're maximizing their utilization? Well, that's because of the ursolic acid, and that helps fight weight increase. It helps you burn calories more efficiently. And the natural substance found in apple peel can partially protect from the harmful effects of obesity. But also, apples are rich in dietary fiber and pectins. And that pectin creates a softer, more gelatinous fiber in the intestine, which helps clean the walls of the intestines, helping to breathe that might otherwise be contaminated or be putrefying, like meat, washes it out of the system. And that's important, too, to have healthy bowel habits, not allow food to ferment in there. In fact, whether you eat an apple on an empty stomach or with a meal, it can alter the way your body digests it. And for this reason, it's suggested that fruit be eaten in the morning on an empty stomach. When we eat apples on an empty stomach, the digestive system breaks down the sugars in the fruit quickly and allows us to get the full nutritional benefit. And pectin, P-E-C-T-I-N, can also help protect the lactic acid and help the bacteria present in it to better colonize in your colon, meaning helping the bio substance to colonize good, healthy, life-supporting bacteria. Now, this will further help in promoting a healthier digestive tract, and pectins in apples can help get rid of toxins and leads to the elimination of carcinogens and a substance responsible for producing cancer. So if you eat apples at night or in the evening, this pro-digestive fruit can turn against you. And so you don't want to overwhelm that system. And this means apples at night can produce some gas, but apples in the morning do not. So eat your apples in the morning, apple juice, apple sauce, apple butter, in the morning, not at night. Also, the organic acid in apples can increase the stomach acid more than normal levels and can, in effect, impact your bowel movements. So try an apple first thing in the morning before you have anything else, and it can make a difference. Also, apple juice is good, too. From the University of Michigan, a study about our brain-gut communication in a laboratory experiment demonstrates how organs can work together to regulate lifespan. Now, our bodies are not just passively growing older. Most people consider, well, it's inevitable. I'll never forget when I was growing up, I would go to my in-laws, and they were all very nice people. And I would talk with them, and there was one that was overweight, my Aunt Helen, and she had diabetes, and she had all kinds of heart problems. And I asked her, why can't you lose weight? And I remember her distinctly telling me as a kid, well, it's normal when you've grown up to gain weight, and diabetes is normal. She was telling me all these things were normal, and therefore, in the culture that I grew up in, normal meant don't fight it, expect it, accept it, it's inevitable. Well, none of these were inevitable. I remember my friend Tony Bartlett, I was one of, I think, only two people in the entire town who had a friend, close friend. My two best friends were Tom Croft and Tony Bartlett. that were African American. And so I had a chance to go in their homes every day and down to Clay Street, which was a segregated street. And diabetes was rampant. I mean, everybody, every household had someone who had diabetes. And I remember sitting there once, and there was a woman who was Tony's aunt, and she was on a sewing machine, and she was sewing, and she had a big bowl of candy. And she said, "Do you want some?" And I looked in the bowl, and my mom had taught me, you know, to be polite and but not to eat candy. So I said, "No, thank you. I'm going to have dinner soon." And we were told never have any sweets before dinner because it would kill your appetite. And she would just sit there all day long and eat candy. I watched her. And, of course, she gained weight. She didn't exercise. She had diabetes. And it was considered normal. That was the environment that I grew up in. Now, I don't know if you grew up in a similar environment where things were considered, that's the way it is. You simply have to accept it. And so most people simply accepted it. And that went on for several generations. Today, of course, we have new knowledge, but we have more people with diabetes than we did then. More overweight people, more people with heart disease, cancers, more people with depression and anxiety disorders, more suicides. All these things have only gotten worse. So clearly, we're not changing the paradigm. So when you understand that everything you take into your body, it's not just comfort food, it's not just dealing with your appetite, but that food is breaking down. And once it's in your intestine and the bacteria are going to come from that or be a part of that, then that bacterial gut will communicate its bacteria with your brain, with your heart. And we never knew this in the past. If you told someone 30 years ago, you know the bacteria that's in your gut? Well, that actually communicates every millisecond, billions of them, with what goes on in your brain. Someone say, "You're crazy." No, that's absolutely proven science today. But here's what people refuse still to accept. The quality of the food that you consume either creates healthy bacteria or disease-producing bacteria. Hot dogs, hamburgers, french fries, pizzas, milkshakes, diet sodas create disease-producing bacteria. Good quality vegetable, plant-based diet, juices, sprouts, fruits, veggies create good bacteria. So understand that the bacteria communicate based upon likes. There's a symbiosis. So now the recent research at the University of Michigan Life Science Institute reveals how some of that crosstalk between tissues occurs in a common model organism. And recent research has shown that signaling between the intestine and the brain can regulate a range of biochemical processes. So far, research has focused mainly on how signals from your gut, that's your intestine, your colon, your rectum, your small intestine, large intestine, transverse intestine, how all that area can affect neurological functions, including some neurodegenerative diseases. Now, much less known about how the brain communicates with the gut to affect certain biological processes such as aging. So we now know that a healthy diet allows for healthier bacteria, which allows for healthier communication, and that is important. Also from Green Med Info, and they're doing good work over there. Sarah G is doing absolutely great work, and congratulations, Sarah G, for your having an outstanding repository of quality scientific studies supporting healthy lifestyle. We are spending hundreds of billions of dollars a year on diabetes, but we're not getting it right. Diabetes is a very big business. The pharmaceutical industry's drugs do not slow it down and do not reverse it ever. And tragically, while the number of diabetes diagnoses continues to expand globally, the drugs themselves, including the GMO-produced insulin, appear to actually increase death. And that's unfortunate. In other words, the resistance within the conventional medical system against finding both the causes and the cures for the diabetes epidemic is institutional and economically motivated, which is to say fundamentally unethical. This happens to be why alternative health sites like GreenMedInfo continue to enjoy expanding popularity around the world. There's no shortage of research on natural solutions to both type 1 and type 2 diabetes. You heard me right, type 1 as well. The mainstream medicine simply says can never be cured. They're wrong. In fact, back in 2014, we reported on a truly groundbreaking finding published in the American Diabetes Association's very own diabetes care journal, which found a turmeric extract known as curcumin, C-U-R, cure, cumin, C-U-M-I-N, was 100% effective in prevention of the progression from pre-diabetes to diabetes. And we have about 60 million Americans suffering from pre-diabetes. Obviously, turmeric possesses a wide range of side effects, but are all beneficial, making this finding all the more promising for those under conventional care. Clearly, if these spectacular results have been obtained through an FDA-approved drug instead of a plant that grows freely, that's inexpensive, that has no negative side effects, it would have made global headlines as one of the greatest achievements of modern pharmaceutical medicine. Fortunately, it appears that academic interest in turmeric and diabetes is picking up. A recent report focused on the work of an Indian scientist, a Professor Gang, working out of the University of Newcastle's Nutraceutical Research Group, and that found that turmeric's anti-diabetic properties are related to its well-known anti-inflammatory properties. And Dr. Gang is presently designing a clinical trial to go even further on this. But we know definitely in a randomized controlled trial that curcumin turns off inflammation and diabetes is pro-inflammatory. So just important side effect on that. And tomorrow I'm going to talk about scientists have finally come to a consensus on the hidden secret of the immortality enzyme. Never heard of an immortality enzyme? Every single one of you have it in your body, but are you activating it? No, you're not. Why not? We'll discuss that. So you won't want to miss this latest research from Arizona State University, and I'll tell you what this enzyme is, how it works, how you can use it to slow down and stop and reverse many of your aging processes. It's not difficult. Also tomorrow, I'm going to give you more in-depth information on the benefits of clumsy, K-A-L-O-N-J-I. It's also called nigella seeds. Really powerful. Or what you've heard me talk about in the past, black cumin. Black cumin, nigella, clumsy, they're all the same. And it's in the buttercup family of flowering plants. But boy, is it a healer. Those are for tomorrow. That's our health and nutrition report for today. We're 19 minutes into our program. We're going to take a break and come right back. Please stay with us. For all the stations that carry this syndicated program, for our sister station where I've been going on 42 years, WBAI, and around the world, those of you who are listening over your apps or over the telephone or the computer, I welcome you and thank you for sharing the information with other people. Here are some of the upcoming guests. I told you at the beginning of the year, we are really loading in the best minds on the planet. Yesterday, you heard Colonel Lawrence Worklesen, and last night, you heard an entire hour with William Binney. Now, it was so powerful. His statements were unbridled. They were honest. They were direct. And he was there at the beginning of the National Security Agency. And for 30 years, he was one of its heads in a major division until he saw its corruption, total and complete corruption, where they want complete control over the public. And he said that. He's not a conspiracy person. He is a very grounded scientist. So tomorrow, I'm going to play that on all the syndicated stations, including our sister station, WBAI in New York. So tomorrow, a full of the conversations with Remarkable Mind on the Progressive Commentary Hour, so you can hear the power of what he's saying, because it is prophetic. He's saying we live in a complete, total, current fascist state with a totalitarian regime overseen by these best and brightest people out of Ivy League colleges, more often than not, who are ruthless and mercenary in the extreme. Okay, so we need to know that. Now also, today we have Michael Mann coming up in about 10 minutes, and then we have tomorrow Dr. Joseph Cristiano. He's going to tell us the latest on stem cell research. There's a revolution going on in stem cell research and how it can help your aging process. Then we have Kerry Gilliam, a veteran health and environmental journalist for over 30 years, shares her years of investigation into the corruption of Monsanto and its means of concealing the truth about its pesticides, particularly Roundup and other products. And we also have coming up Robert J. Lifton. He is a 50-year practicing psychiatrist, and he's going to talk about all of the real causes of depression and anxiety, and it's not an imbalance in brain chemistry. And he's done some remarkable studies that show the power of nuclear weapons, and he's going to talk about what it means to be involved in conflict like the Vietnam War and how that impacts us. And then we also have Vegas Tenold, a Norwegian investigative reporter who infiltrated three of America's largest white nationalist organizations for 5 years. And he'll explain the reasons why we are witnessing a rebirth and growth in white nationalism in the United States. So those are some upcoming programs. We promise we bring you the best, and we are. One of my concerns, as is John Whitehead, and we want to thank him for his scholarship and op-ed news, is how we don't have enough money to do everything we need to do. And instead of doing nothing for the rich, which we shouldn't do, because they control so much already, and they're not paying their fair share taxes, never have, and we detail that, how the 50 top corporations pay no taxes, some actually get billions of dollars in rebates. We gave them the biggest tax cut ever, and it does not help the average person. In fact, there's no money left for a lot of other important projects like infrastructure. Why? Because we're spending it on war. We throw money at defense when everything is falling down around us. So the question is this, and one that John Whitehead, who you'll be hearing on a regular basis, I'm giving him a weekly show, because we're going to have a group of five constitutional attorneys who work for the public, who are going to be sharing a forum on how our Constitution is being shredded. Oh, and by the way, I'm going to be interviewing people because I want to see two new shows. I want to see a show where Palestinian spokespersons and Jewish spokespersons come together to talk on the air, honestly, but diplomatically, where we understand their perspectives with the object of healing the trauma, healing the wounds that have been inflicted upon both, and overcoming biases and dogmas and stigmas and misrepresentations of what the other is, and try to find the sacred in both, and having an open, honest forum where people can call in and share their points of view, and where we can be reasonable in listening to see if there's any measure of merit in another person's statements, instead of before they even say anything, we hate them. And that's unfortunately what is more common now than ever before. So I believe that we need forms for healing, including cultural healing and the divisiveness that exists because of the media and its own agenda. So if you're a person who would be a good spokesperson for that, please feel free to contact us at prnstudio@gmail.com, and we'll be doing interviews till we find the right combination. In any case, we don't have money to spend on inner cities. We don't have money to feed hungry children, nor to house the homeless. We should. We have plenty of resources. We have plenty of empty buildings that could be converted. We have ways of dealing with them, but instead of helping the poor, we are punishing them. We have criminalized being poor, but we have not criminalized warmongers. We have not criminalized the Clintons or Bushes, the Cheneys or Rumsfelds. We haven't criminalized the Trumps and others who call in the generals and call in the Council on Foreign Relations, the mastermind behind so much of this, warmongering, neoliberalism, to hold them accountable. And that's unfortunate. Instead, we lavish money, $700 billion a year, in above-line money, another $700 billion below-line. So it's about $1.4 trillion a year. Ask yourself this. Do we need 1.4 million active military personnel and 850,000 reserves when the enemy at the moment, ISIS, numbers in the low thousands or 10,000? If so, it seems there's something radically wrong with our strategy. Should 57% of the federal budget's discretionary spending go to the military and only 3% to transportation when the toll on American lives is far greater from failing infrastructure than from terrorism? Does California need nearly as many active military bases? They have 31 just in California, as it has University of California and State University campuses at 33. And does the state need more active duty military personnel, 168,000, according to the government magazine, than public elementary school teachers at 139,000. Something's wrong when in the state, largest state in America, the most populous state in America, California, with around more or less 39 million people, you have more active armed individuals in the military than you do school teachers. Mark my words, America's war spending will bankrupt the nation. And for that matter, America's war spending has already bankrupted the nation to $20 trillion. Now, the Trump administration is pushing for a $4.4 trillion budget for this next year that would add $7 trillion to the already unsustainable federal deficit in order to sustain America's military empire abroad and dramatically expand the police state here at home. Trump also wants American taxpayers to cover the cost of building that infamous, stupid border wall. Truly, Trump may turn out to be, as policy analyst Stan Collingder warned, the biggest deficit debt-increasing president of all time. And for those in need of a quick reminder, a budget deficit is the difference between what the federal government spends and what it takes in. The national debt, also known as the public debt, is the result of the federal government borrowing money to cover years and years of budget deficits. So right now, the U.S. government is operating in the negative on every front. It's spending far more than what it makes and takes from the taxpayers even more, and the Social Security Fund even more, over $2.3 trillion from the Social Security Fund, which should never get a penny, and it's borrowing heavily, all to fund its endless wars abroad. This is how military empires fall and fail, by spending themselves too thin in deficits and spending themselves to death. It happened in Rome. It's happening again. So not content to merely police the globe in recent decades, America has gradually transformed its homeland into a battlefield with militarized police and weapons better suited to a war zone. Since taking office, President Trump, much like his predecessor, has marched in lockstep with the military-industrial complex. Now Trump wants $716 billion to expand America's military and billions more to hire cops and billions more to build more prisons and wage more profit-driven war on drugs and war on terrorism and war on crime programs that simply eat away at the Fourth Amendment while failing to make the country any safer. Did it ever occur what might happen if in countries that have a large population coming to America or wanting to come to America, legally or not, what if we were to build large numbers of schools that taught people English and taught them our culture, and that America has no one culture, we have multiple cultures depending upon where you live, but at least allowed them to have the tools necessary so that when they came, they didn't end up as exploited migrants in dangerous working environments and seasonal work at best, being exploited to the max in California and Florida and other states? Why not in their countries prepare them for a higher quality transition with their government to ours, giving them the tools to help them master crafts they might not have, may not otherwise have. We're just doing everything wrongheadedly. But no matter how you break it down, this is not a budget aimed at perfecting the union and establishing justice and ensuring domestic tranquility or providing for the common defense or promoting general welfare or de-ghettoizing American schools, neighborhoods, or strengthening the quality of the curriculum and the safety of schools so children can learn and that learning can help them become more critical thinkers. No. What we have today is a military-industrial complex that controls both parties, controls the media, and runs the deep state and holds virtually every agency of government in its clutches. So much for Trump campaign promises to balance the budget and drain the swamps of corruption. He's merely added more swamp creatures and passes over it. The glaring economic truth is at the end of the day, the military-industrial complex, and not the sick and the elderly or the poor, are pushing America towards bankruptcy. And finally, as investigative journalist Uri Friedman puts it, for more than 15 years now, the United States has been fighting terrorism with a credit card, essentially bankrolling the wars with debt in the form of purchases of the U.S. Treasury bonds by the U.S.-based entities like pension funds and state and local governments in countries like China and Japan. The illicit merger of the armaments industry and the Pentagon that President Dwight Eisenhower warned us about 50 years ago has come to present perhaps the greatest threat to the nation's fragile infrastructure today. And having been co-opted by greedy defense contractors and corrupt politicians and incompetent government officials, America's expanding military empire is bleeding the country dry at a rate of more than $15 billion a month. That's $20 million every 60 minutes. And that's just what the government spends on foreign wars. That does not include the cost of maintaining and staffing 1,000-plus military bases around the globe. Incredibly, although the U.S. constitutes only 5% of the world's population, America boasts almost 50% of the world's total military expenditure, spending more on the military than the next 19 nations combined. In fact, the Pentagon spends more on war than all 50 states combined spend on health, education, welfare, and safety. So understand war is not cheap. It costs us $8,300,000 per hour in Afghanistan and Iraq. That's every hour. So, and what do we get for it? Legions of young men and women coming home so traumatized they're willing to take their own lives, and 23 a day do, and not having the money for their other structures that we need, infrastructures, roads and high-speed rails and de-ghettoizing our communities and a better quality of life for people in the middle class who've shrunk to the poor class. So, something to think about. We're going to take a break and come back with my guests. Please stay with us. And by the way, if the Democrat Party starts telling you how they support a Medicare for all, don't be fooled. They want to keep the profit in the medical-industrial complex, and the entire medical-industrial complex must be completely changed and take the profit out of it so we have universal health care, which is not in any way manipulated, as they now tend to do. I'll do more of that on an upcoming program. I gave you the biography of Professor Michael Mann, Distinguished Research Professor of Sociology at University of California, Berkeley, a little earlier in the introduction of our program. He's on the line now from Los Angeles. Nice to have you with us today.
Nice to be here, Gary. Thank you.
I'd like for you to unpack a statement you wrote 15 years ago in your 2003 publication, Incoherent Empire, which was actually a prediction you made for the end result of the war on terror that the Bush administration launched back in 9/11 and the invasions of Afghanistan and Iraq. You wrote, "The American empire will turn out to be a military giant, a backseat economic driver, a political schizophrenic, and an ideological phantom." Now, I feel it's certainly fair to say that if we look at the U.S. current agenda in military expansionism and our unconscionable economic, multinational, corporate, and banking regime, the pathological dysfunction in our political bodies and our nation's ideological faux democracy and civil liberties at this time in the Trump era, your observations were extraordinarily accurate, acute, and poignant. So please take your time and share with us what you were observing back in 2003 when the war on terror became institutionalized into the American domestic, international, and defense and national security policy state that led you to make this prediction about our military, economic, and political and ideology. The forum is yours.
Thank you. I should preface my remarks by saying that I am both an American and a British citizen. And I got enraged in 2001-2003 about our response to 9/11 and our invasions of Afghanistan and Iraq, which I predicted would be disastrous failures. And I think that's turned out to be the case. What I said that the core of those invasions was that America had the military power to defeat any other formal army in the world, and so it could easily take over Afghanistan and Iraq. But it was a political, well, a political pygmy, if you like, meaning that it didn't have the power to remake the political systems of foreign countries. Things had changed since the days of empire, of genuine empires in the 19th century, where an imperial invasion would be greeted by the local leaders, and they would think, now, who's going to win? Is it the imperialists, or is it my king or my emir or whatever? And if they thought that the imperialists would win, they sided with the imperialists. That doesn't happen now. It used to happen on a lesser scale in Latin America and elsewhere, where the U.S. interventions could be reliably supported by conservatives and capitalists. But it's not like that, especially in Islamic countries. And so I predicted that the U.S. would be unable to establish secure political regimes. I said that in the case of Iraq, they would have to fall back on the position of establishing what we call an ethnocracy, which is the rule of one ethnic group over others. A little more complicated in Iraq because there are three groups. The regime is essentially Shia, but with Kurdish support, and the Sunnis are excluded from power. That is not democracy, of course, it's ethnocracy. In Afghanistan, we intervened in a 70-year-old civil war, which we had no hope whatever of solving. And these interventions have resulted in the killing of a very large number of civilians. Nobody knows exactly how many in Iraq, but it must be something like 700,000 or something like that. And some casualties among American forces, but not many because of the incredible firepower of the U.S. military, and it brought no benefit to those countries. The curious situation in Iraq is, in fact, that we're aiding Iran, supposedly our enemy, who is, as a Shia power, is allied with the Iraqi Shias who now run the country. So those invasions did nothing. They had one benefit afterwards, which is they made the notion of further military interventions unpopular among Americans. And our present regime, which would dearly like to have boots on the ground in various situations, feels it cannot do that because that would be unpopular. And that's likely to last for another decade or so until these disasters are forgotten, and then perhaps there will be more interventions. But for the moment, there may be a lot of bluster by American leaders, especially Trump, but they're not actually going to follow them up as they did at the beginning of the 21st century. But there are, obviously, there are, especially in the Middle East, there are significant American interventions. The Iraq conflict has spread to Syria. We are, again, unable to determine the outcome of struggles between local groups. And, of course, in Syria, we have been worsted by Russia, propping up the Assad regime. One worrying feature of American policy in the Middle East at the moment is that we seem to be committing ourselves to to support for Sunni Islam against Shia. That means the leading Shia power is Iran, the leading Sunni power is Saudi Arabia, and we are supporting Saudi Arabia against Iran. And the most terrible part of this is our participation in the civil war in the Yemen. There are no interests whatever at stake in the Yemen. It doesn't have oil, it doesn't have anything of any great value. There's a genuine civil war going on, and that roughly aligns Shia against Sunni. Iran aids one side, Saudi Arabia the other, and we provide considerable assistance to Saudi Arabia in establishing what targets might be hit and in selling them very considerable amounts of arms. We're not the only ones that do that. The British and the French do that as well. But this is supposedly a Yemeni civil war, but like so many civil wars in the world, it actually involves foreign powers. I can see no earthly reason why the US should support one side in the Yemeni civil war against the other. And clearly, every one of these interventions, from Afghanistan to Iraq and the Yemen, these bring blowback among Muslims. And that's what I warned of in my book, Incoherent Empire, which I wrote just before the American invasion. That blowback, of course, went through a phase of increasing the power of Al-Qaeda, then taken over by ISIS. And luckily for the United States, ISIS made the big mistake of trying to establish a territorial regime. And once you do that, you open yourself up to conventional warfare. And obviously, they were no match for forces supported by the Americans. And so ISIS will go back to being a guerrilla force, one wielding suicide bombs, IEDs, that's improvised explosive devices, and shoulder-held rocket launchers, etc. And that will not end because we're doing everything to provoke a reaction against that. And one can see this clearly in a country like Britain, which has loyally supported American military in all of these exploits, where the substantial Islamic Pakistani community in Britain generates a certain number of discontented young men who commit terrorist atrocities. This was entirely predictable. I predicted it, and it will continue as long as we go in for this military adventure.
I appreciate that overview. Thank you. We frequently hear the term fascism thrown around in the media. The right, the media sources such as Breitbart and Fox, will confuse fascism with socialism or communism. The left, likewise, will toss the term around to demonize conservatives and frequently Trump and others in his cabinet. Clearly, there are frightening factions within the United States, like the white nationalist organizations and the militias, that publicly glorify fascist qualities. Over a decade ago, you wrote a separate book entitled Fascist that compared six fascistic nations to find elements they have in common. And your conclusions were that they all express violent, transcendent national statism. Can you explain what you meant by this? And to what degree are we witnessing this definition of fascism emerging in the United States? And do we have, in many respects, fascism with a velvet glove, where the people, unlike Trump, who is as coarse as a piece of Brillo pad wiped across a baby's ass, with his intellect, non-existing intellect, his manners that are subprimordial and reptilian. But think of Obama and think of Clinton, extremely charismatic and charming. But then look at their policies. You know, how do you sit down with someone and glorify them as the media did when a man has his Tuesday sit-down kill list with over 1,000 people that he intends to kill without any court or guilty verdict, without any evidence that a person could defend? That's an extrajudicial killing by any measure, and yet the entire media has gone to sleep behind we confuse what we like about a person with their actual deeds, and yet every one of those people had that silken glove. But inside that was the iron fist of fatal fascism. Your thoughts, please.
Right. Well, classic fascism, that is fascism between World War I and World War II, embodied a kind of extreme nationalism, extreme statism, by which I mean they worshipped the state. They wanted to give more power to the state because the state could accomplish a better society, they argued, and if necessary, this would be accomplished through violence, which they thought was a virtue, not a vice. It emerged primarily because of the consequences of World War I, which left an enormous number of embittered military veterans across the defeated powers in Europe, and they became the first core of fascist movements. Now, I'm a little bit reluctant to label contemporary rightist nationalists, racists sometimes. I'm a bit reluctant to call them fascists. They, in particular, there are not many that glorify the state and see it as capable of major social transformation. And you've got to remember, there were national socialists as well as national fascist conservatives, and the kind of socialist wing of that did have various populist objectives. The problem about calling contemporary leaders fascist is that they mostly, firstly, they work through the electoral systems of the West. They have rowdy street demonstrations. Some of their language is very violent, but they're generally careful. If they're not careful, then they tend to fall foul of the law and get put in prison. And they are also, they're more likely to be neoliberal than they are to be statists. That is, they have effected an alliance with neoliberal economic theory and want less government interference in the economy. So that's different. We need new labels. I prefer to call them authoritarian populists. It's perfectly true that Trump, in his deepest thoughts, is almost certainly someone one might call a fascist, but he is restrained by, to some degree, by the American political system. Now, fascism is not the only undesirable force in the world, nor was it in the 1930s. And I, too, would prefer that the U.S. Was not militaristic abroad. And I would agree that the succession of presidents, post-war presidents, have included almost no one, perhaps Jimmy Carter alone, who had any profound sentiments towards peace and conciliation rather than solving problems for America by force. And clearly, Obama did that as much as Trump. Trump's rhetoric goes further, but the actions are only very slightly more extreme than Obama's. But I'm not sure that it helps to call that fascist. Of course, there is always the power of the state, to arrest and jail people. But that's much broader than just fascism. So I'm a bit reluctant to follow you in that respect.
Okay. Final question. Hillary Clinton stated during the presidential campaign that Russia is our nation's greatest threat. Yet the U.S. has over 900 military bases and installations around the globe. And on the African continent, we are rapidly expanding our military presence. The Pentagon's African Command, or AFRICOM, was only started in 2006 towards the end of the Bush-Cheney administration. And on the other hand, Russia only has a handful, under five military bases on its borders, and yet they are supposed to be the world's greatest threat. Your final thoughts, please.
Well, the world's greatest threat is the United States, obviously. That number of forces, 1.4 million American troops, 450,000 of them stationed abroad, very many bases. These are all indications of America's desire to solve problems around the world with force. And Russia has had a much more modest agenda of extending its power, first of all, over Russian speakers in the Crimea and eastern Ukraine, and then establishing an alliance with Assad, and probably will seek to do more of that. But it is very much a regional power and not a global power. Obviously, the rise of China is something that the U.S. has to come to terms with. There's no sign at the moment that it is willing to conciliate with China rather than to talk the rhetoric of confrontation. And that would be very worrying indeed, because given any encouragement, I think China would try and reestablish itself as the empire over Asia. But is Russia a threat? Well, Russia is a threat to the Western Ukraine, but then the Western Ukraine is a threat to the Eastern Ukraine. So, and Russia's support for Assad and the complicity in the bombing is something to be deplored. but I don't really think that Russia is a power of the to the extent that the US is, and the US, by having all of this military power, is not a friendly state to the world.
I certainly appreciate you coming on and sharing the depth of your wisdom with us. Thank you very much. Professor Michael Mann, Distinguished Research Professor of Sociology, University of California, and the author of Incoherent Empire, as well as The Sources of Social Power. I'm Gary Null. Thank you all for listening. Have a nice day.